Penguin Random House Audio presents Master of the Senate, The Years of Lyndon Johnson, Book 3, Part 3 of a three-part recording by Robert A. Caro, read by Grover Gardner.
Part 5, The Great Cause. Chapter 30, The Rising Tide. If an American citizen of African descent, a Negro, to use the term then in common usage, wanted to register to vote in Bullock County, Alabama, during the 1950s, he had to register under what the county's board of registrars called the voucher system. He was required to bring with him a supporting witness, called by the board a voucher, to attest to his character, morals, and general fitness to be a voter. But only Bullock County residents who were already registered voters were eligible to be supporting witnesses, and no witness could vouch for more than three persons during each four-year term of the board. And since, by inviolate Bullock County custom, no white person would ever vouch for a Negro, eligible vouchers for Bullock Negroes were in rather short supply. For out of the county's 11,000 Negro residents, exactly five were registered voters. This meant, of course, that no more than 15 Negroes could be registered during any four-year period, but even this number was apparently more than the board was disposed to allow, as a small group of Negroes, perhaps a half dozen, learned when, on January 18, 1954, they showed up at the board's office in the Bullock County Courthouse in Union Springs with their supporting witnesses. "What's your trouble?" Board Chairman S.B. Wilson asked them brusquely, and when one of them, Aaron Sellers, a 40-year-old farmer, replied that they were there to register, Wilson said, "Well, we're busy today. You all come back tomorrow." They returned the next day. Wilson and his fellow board members let them sit there for an hour until finally another white man, Alan B. Tucker, who, as a federal judge was to note, was not connected with the board in any official capacity, came over to them and asked the same question, "What's your trouble?" Sellers, speaking for the group, said, "We were here yesterday and the chairman told us to come back today." Tucker asked them why they wanted to vote. Sellers said something to the effect that they wanted to vote because they were citizens, and Tucker said, "You all are citizens already. You pay taxes, don't you? If I were you, I would go back home." And when they didn't take his advice but remained sitting, the board continuing to ignore them, for perhaps another half hour, the veneer of civility, thin though it was, disappeared entirely. Returning to the room, Tucker stood over the Negroes and said in a low, threatening voice, "I thought I told you to get the hell out of here." The Negroes were all aware not only of incidents of violence against members of their race who had defied white wishes, but of other forms of intimidation as well. The white people in the town kept a list of the names of who was trying to vote, and they kept the list in their pockets for ready reference, Sellers would recall. There were many ways in which that list could be used. Word had been passed that the banks were organizing and might stop lending colored people money, he says. The county's impoverished Negro farmers would shortly, in March or April, need crop loans, money to buy seed and fertilizer to plant their cotton and peanut crops. And, as Sellers says, "You had to have a little to live on, too, you know, until the crops were harvested in October." Tucker's threat was effective. "We were all somewhat afraid," Sellers says. "We got up and left." When he decided to make another attempt on February 1st, he was able to persuade only three men to come with him. Not that it made much difference. Their approach to the courthouse had been noted, and this time when they walked up the stairs and knocked on the door to the board of registrar's office, there was no reply. And when Sellers finally worked up the nerve to open the door, the room was empty. Encountering a white courthouse clerk in a corridor, the four Negroes asked where the board was meeting, and the clerk, a smirk on his face, said he didn't know. Afraid to go looking in every office, the Negroes finally left the courthouse and stood outside, waiting for the registrars to come out and go to lunch. When they returned, they followed them to the unmarked office in the basement in which they had been meeting. But although all three members of the board went into the room, when Sellers knocked on the door, only Wilson appeared, stepping through the door and closing it quickly behind him. And when Sellers told him that he and his friends wanted to register, Wilson, as Sellers was to recall, told us he couldn't register us because he was alone and the law required two at least to be present. They knew now that the board was not going to allow them to register, Sellers was to say, so we didn't go back anymore. Instead, they decided to go to law to sue the Board of Registrars for denying them the chance to vote. We were citizens. We knew the law said citizens could vote, Sellers was to say. We thought we would win. They found an attorney, Arthur D. Scholes of Birmingham, one of the handful of black lawyers in Alabama, who was willing to represent them, and Scholes brought suit in federal district court in Montgomery, the state capital, asking for a declaratory judgment that the board had discriminated against them, and for an injunction prohibiting the board from such discrimination and ordering it to use the same criteria for registering Negroes as it did for whites. The Federal Bureau of Investigation had no difficulty in confirming their story. No sooner had an FBI agent looking for witnesses entered a pool hall in Union Springs and pulled out his badge than Tucker told him proudly, "I just run off a bunch of niggers who were trying to vote." But then, having gone to the law, they found out there was no law that could help them. The district court judge, Charles Kennemer, ruled in ringing words that their cause was just. The board's actions, whenever the plaintiffs appeared before them, amounted to discrimination solely because the plaintiffs were members of the Negro race, he wrote. The supreme law of this republic is that no voter can be discriminated against. Therefore, let no board of registrars try to devise any scheme or artifice to do otherwise. The words didn't mean much, however, as even the judge had to admit. By the time he issued his ruling, it was irrelevant. While the trial was still going on, the three members of the board simply resigned. And in his ruling, Kennemer had to admit that, by virtue of their resignations, the defendants are now beyond the veil of an injunctive directive from this court. There was no point in ordering them to register Negroes. They couldn't register Negroes any longer. No one in Bullock County could register Negroes. In his ruling, the judge promised that the court will grant injunctive relief in the event these defendants again become members of the board. The defendants did not again become members of the board. They stayed resigned until their terms expired in 1956. During this time, their posts remained unfilled. Vacancies were supposed to be filled by a state agency, but the state agency didn't fill the vacancies for more than 2 years. And Aaron Sellers and his friends were told that there was no law that could compel the state to fill them. And when, in 1957, a new, different board of registrars was appointed, and Sellers and his friends returned, hoping for a better result, they found the board office again empty. "We couldn't find out where the board were," he says, and they realized they would have to begin the same laborious legal proceeding all over again, with, almost certainly, the same result at the end of it. All across the South, the 11 states of the old Confederacy that stretched in a great crescent from the Atlantic Ocean to the plains of West Texas, black American citizens being discriminated against, not only in voting, but in housing, in employment, in virtually every aspect of life, were trying during the 1950s to turn to the law so that they could enjoy the same rights as white Americans. And all across the South, black Americans were finding what the blacks of Bullock County had found, that there was no law that could help them. Once, long before, for a brief period, there had been such laws. Some had been woven into the fabric of the Constitution that was America's highest law. The three great Civil War amendments to the Constitution had been passed to give force to the concept of the equality of all men which had been proclaimed in the Declaration of Independence, but which had then, in submission to the slaveholding South, been omitted from the Constitution itself. The 13th Article, in addition to and amendment of the Constitution, outlawed the institution of slavery. The 14th made former slaves citizens, full citizens entitled to due process of law, to the equal protection of the laws, to all the rights, the sacred privileges and immunities of citizens. The 15th made specific that among the rights of these new citizens was the right to vote, the right on which all other rights rest in a democracy in which governmental powers were derived from the consent of the governed. The right of citizens to vote shall not be denied or abridged by any state on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude, the 15th Amendment proclaimed. Each of the amendments or articles had an identical final clause. Congress shall have power to enforce this article by appropriate legislation. And in the decade immediately after the terrible war, a vengeful Congress determined to reconstruct the South had exercised that power, accepted that responsibility, enacting specific national statutes to give teeth to those guarantees. In 1866, it passed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.